We'll see what Atlanta decides to roll out with here, where Atlanta has been more willing to head out on more DPS heavy composition. So Sugar Free very well could be on the 76, where return to form. But as I say that, no, not going to be on the 76 this time around. Going to be more standard 3-3, same for Uprising. And if you're Atlanta, you also have no reason to do anything but a 3-3 mirror until Uprising actually surprises you.
I mean, you just had a great performance earlier in the season and also just at Atlantic Showdown the season before, 3-3, so why would you swap off? Uprising now looking to drop down from this higher ground. They've held onto the higher ground a little bit longer while the point is still waiting to unlock. They want to drop down at the best possible moment.
I'm looking forward to get pretty good poke on the Kodak. Kodak gonna be getting the armor pack, which means Gator is more vulnerable here. Trying to go in the Gator while the armor pack is down. Uprising though getting counter poked as they dove in. Atlanta with a chance to bring it on forward. Punk in real danger. Punk gonna get demacked. This is a good start here from Atlanta, who now have all the room in the world to work with and roll into Uprising. Uprising just getting swept away.
Uprising did not have a bad initial fight for that, but Punk way too aggressive on the off angle. He was playing in main. He was playing in Atlanta's main, looking to put presence, and then just gets bashed by Sugar Free and then cleaned up by Hawk. He had the Discord on him as well, just instant Discord focus. That was way too large of an off angle for Punk. And the neutral fights, those off angles can be extremely valuable, but if you're too far away from your team and if you're too aggressive, you're gonna get caught.
So pressure coming in as Uprising goes high ground once more, but they're getting poked down as they move in, and worse than that, Atlanta is looking very good on ult charge. So Uprising, they're gonna drop on down what into what could be a meat grinder. Sugar Free opening with the rally. Shatter gonna be invested by Tidawatt, doesn't get anything. And but now Tidawatt gonna get grabbed, but okay, Gator went to fall through, ends up falling. Sits on five for Uprising. They might have an opportunity here. Rally of their own. Gonna be up a little bit longer, and Atlanta might have to give some ground here as Hawk gets demacked.
Hawk sets the bomb as well, and I think now they do get the pick, so there's still a fight potential, there's still the trance out, and Atlanta, they brought it back with the trance, they're waiting for Gator.
Gator gonna be back into fight soon, and Atlanta very well could fight this back. Shatter in from Gator, gets nothing. Not where he wanted at all. Sugar Free getting a little bit low, under heavy pressure, 73%, still somehow alive, able to back on out. Sugar Free might have the second rally. The fight here is Atlanta is somehow bringing their way back in. They get Tidawatt, still winnable for Atlanta. Gonna get the rally back on in. Saucy close to another grab and Uprising. Just when you think they've won the fight, they might be getting repelled. Oh no, wait, Kodak.
That's probably finish it off. Swimmer does have that boop. Even though the counter grab for Saucy goes out, that is going to be finished up. The damage so much better for Uprising, who got that flip earlier. Eventually, the fight is done.
Well,
it's not done at all, actually!
Gator dropping another shatter, builds yet another in the middle of the fight!
That should not happen. Gator should not be able to build another shatter and drop it there to win the fight. Gator, despite falling over, flanking for the charge and the grab earlier and having to respawn, he brings it back at the end.
I mean, Gator just breaks rules in general. Should be able to get that many shatters in a fight. Shouldn't be walking into play a competitive series wearing socks and sandals. The man just breaks all the rules.
You can keep your statistics. I prefer the magic of Gator is what I prefer. So Atlanta with the flip already with that time pick advantage too. That Kodak has chance to trade with Scalar. Relatively equal grabs across the board, though Mirror is out building a little bit right now. And Sugar Free about to have another rally.
Bomb gonna be out here. Scalar going for the transcendence, and already the bomb striking pay dirt. Hawk taking down his counterpart. Gator charging on in. And Atlanta real close to finishing off this first round. Got a little bit dicey for a moment.
Dicey? It was crazy. That fight was insane.
Yeah, and yet Gator finishes it out. Uprising, they got some progress there, but nowhere near enough. And again, heading into this matchup, Atlanta's highly favored. Arguably, the fight back we saw from Uprising at points was more than expected, where we haven't touched on too much, but they have made a, I believe, a permanent roster change where Dino is no longer on the team, and Scalar is their new flex support of choice.
So, relatively close showing for Uprising on that first round. If they had just been able to win that fight a little bit more decisively, not have Gator have that mega shatter, which should not have been possible. So, Atlanta now going up against Uprising here again on their second round of Ilios. It is going to be Ruins. No Widow, though. Racing the point. Widow coming out. It's going to be a 3-3 mirror for both squads. And for this neutral fight and for this mid fight, all the Uprising need to make sure is they don't lose anyone on that poke game on those off angles.
Atlanta, definitely better positioning early on here to start things out. Uprising needing to give it a wide berth and then some. Tidawatt eating a lot of damage. And on the other side, Hawk does his own inner email, finds Scalar on the other side, just hits him with the angry titans of I'm Diva, dive the Zenyatta.
And it works out if they're not able to get the fuel on, if they're not able to catch that fuel effectively. So Uprising, backing out, waiting for the respawns, gonna regroup, come back into the next fight. Relatively equal ults across the board. As Uprising here, re-enter from the choke, gonna look to engage, gonna look to try to get the shield pressure, move them back off the point.
Atlanta in a pretty good spot right now. They can just drag out the fight a little bit longer, get ults, re-engage in the Uprising. Uprising, meanwhile, trying to take the fight as soon as possible, and as soon as Klaus gets Rally, it's immediately invested here in this fight, but Gator dropping the Shatter gets nothing. Not quite the right angle. Meanwhile, Tidawatt can have a Shatter of his own. Tidawatt, though, burst it down! Doesn't have the opportunity to drop it. Kodak all over it. Punk holding onto a bomb, but I just don't think this is the time. I think Uprising, they're way too low. Punk gets demeked, and Atlanta, on a mechanical base, is just overwhelming.
Atlanta just currently trading out far better on the shield as well. You see D.Va duels happening in the backline, and the armor packs and the bubbles used earlier, but burned, so there was nothing for Tidawatt. While Saucy spent the entire fight shooting Tidawatt's shield, burning it, there wasn't a cooldown available for him. And 60% for that time bank already on the board for Atlanta. They did have to use that rally, trade it out with Klaus. And Uprising have to find an opening in a fight where they're relatively ult equal besides Shatter.
Well, the Ground Song be coming out here first from Mir, and they go for the classic grab bomb combo. Bomb to the back does get one. Atlanta, they use the grab of their own in the middle of it. Not going to be able to turn the fight. I think Atlanta's going to save the rest of what they have and says, all right, Uprising, you're going to spend that many ults. Have the point. See what it gets them.
Four ults invested for Uprising. I mean, one of those was they had the recontest Saucy's grab. They had to burn that trance anyways. But they invested Shatter, Bomb, Grab. That's four ults gone. 82% already on the board for Atlanta Academy. And when you know that Tidawatt doesn't have Shatter as well, another advantage for Atlanta is there's no trance. There's no Shatter. You just set up Hawk to put that bomb and put Gator in position to put people on the ground, whether from the split or to get them caught by that D.Va bomb. This is a great spot to be for Atlanta in terms of working for the initiation and using that bomb aggressively.
And with how big Bruins is, this is one fight territory. If Atlanta wins a fight and recaps, that is very likely going to be it. Gator connects, puts Tidawatt on the ground, and abducts him, brings him far to the Atlanta side. Tidawatt down, now man advantage to Atlanta, and they can take the time moving on forward. Punk in rough shape, getting poked on down, gets demeked, and this is all going in favor of Atlanta. They're gonna get the recap, and now Uprising, they might be able to get back towards the point, but they're gonna be struggling. Mira has the grab, but how does he get in the good spot to use it?
So now Uprising, they have one last fight to come touch this point to stop the flip. And more importantly, on top of Mira not getting into position to use the grab at all, is that even if they get the grab off, Kodak will have trance and Saucy will have grab of his own.
Also, Hawk might eat this. Nope, Hawk's not over it. The Graviton is going to connect. The Swimmer's down before it even goes in. We're going to see Uprising desperately trying to move in. Transcend's about to fade. The Graviton there for the fall through. The Shatter from Tidawatt not going to be making any room. And Atlanta making this a very, very quick Ilios.
Finishing up those cleanup frags, and once again, the bomb for Uprising is the neutral game. The neutral game is coming that is coming back to bite them, to haunt them at every opportunity, where if you lose that first fight of control, it's already rough, but because it takes long time to get back in and they are just losing neutral fights, they're not, Atlanta's not having to invest ults, they're having the better ult build overall, and then which obviously just leads you to a cascade of consequences, which is you have better ult economy.
And the issue is in Overwatch is that even if there's a skill disparity between the two teams and you can win fights off ults alone, if you are getting outplayed in the neutral to a heavy degree, it doesn't really matter how well you play those, you know, more advanced fights, because you're always going to be at a significant disadvantage. And that's what we saw here, is that Uprising, no matter what the situation was at a disadvantage because they were getting just outpoked on all levels. They were losing the shield war, they were lower on HP, they were more likely to get booped and displaced into bad areas, and it's very difficult to overcome that level of difference in mechanical skill.
It is extremely difficult, because that's not something that's achievable by coaching, right? Mechanical skills, it's from the grind, it's from the talent. It is something that you have it, and you can improve on it, but it takes much longer. It is not a flip of light switch, hey, you're engaging too early with your Matrix, you're engaging too early with your bubbles, you know, you're not saving them for when you need them. It's rather, just aim better, forehead. And that is not something that a coach is gonna be able to do for you.
It's actually one of the most frustrating things to coaches in Overwatch, where, you know, I think it's actually why certain coaches and analysts in the scene will underrate mechanical skill, because, as you say, there's no easy solution. You just sound kind of silly when you go, ah, just get good. And he's like, well, what are you supposed to do? And unfortunately here for Uprising is that it is a very tough matchup where Atlanta's dealing with a lot of players that, you know, you have players like Gator that are already on two-way contracts, or Funny Astro, and players that would be on two-way contracts, I believe, like Hawk, if Hawk was old enough. So you're dealing with a near OWL caliber team in Atlanta Academy, and you see the results of it right now, where just winning in the neutral, the key phrase right now for Uprising, and I don't know what they're going to be able to do to sort of bridge the gap, because it's very difficult. I would guess if nothing else, maybe don't run the mirror.
I think for Uprising, if they're committed to the 3-3, number one assessment, stop going for off angles and losing those neutral fights on mid points, on first fights, on purely ult neutral fights. You can't overaggress on off angles. Secondly, their cooldown usage so far has been kind of atrocious, which is not, that's not a mechanical thing. They're using bubbles, they're using arm packs very early because they're taking so much poke. They reduce the amount of poke they take. If they save more cooldowns for Tito Watt, who wants to be aggressive at times and wants to be that space creator, but isn't able to because he's losing the shield war and is hoping for more cooldowns. Those two things right there, immediately, right off the bat, if they can mitigate damage and stop losing off-angle fights, then I think they're at a much better spot. And that doesn't require them to now just shoot the enemy better.
Just shoot the enemy better. Well, it's going to be Uprising here on the attack first. Atlanta choosing to defend. And for Atlanta, I think they're choosing to defend because, you know, if I were to ask them later, I just think they want to go through the series as quick as possible. And if you feel you're the better team, doing early defense can make for a much quicker map.
So Atlanta playing that standard 3-3 defense. Uprising, going to be getting a little bit of scout here. Looks like they're going to be committing to, nope, actually going to go back to 3-3 themselves, but with Scalar on the Ana rather than the Zen. No. Okay, I see. They're putting Mirror onto the Zarya so you can play that pick. Punk going to be swapping to the Sombra. So they will be playing a Sombra go to Sombra style with Scalar on the Ana. And looking to engage.
Atlanta, meanwhile, just holding up, waiting for Uprising. And for Uprising, I mean, again, with the composition they're running, it really depends how quick Punk is going to be able to build EMP here. Atlanta is more than willing to just sit here and go, all right, we're going to sit here on top and counter poke you. And Punk right now not building EMP very quickly at all.
He's not building EMP extremely quickly because he's prioritizing the point here a little bit. See Uprising, they move in. They're going to try to back up, bait this push, this fall down. There's a huge nade out onto Atlanta. Can't Uprising follow up?
Well, they're looking for it right now. Hawk getting low, Gator getting a little bit low as well, but Bionade has faded. The time to heal up is there. Kodak under pressure, though, on the other side. 86% to Transcendence. If he healed on up, now we'll get the early Transcendence to boot. And this is a little bit problematic for the Uprising, where now Transcendence is going to be already up, way in advance of Mirror having Graviton, in fact. And Atlanta, they're able to rotate forward back to full strength.
The ideal fight for Uprising, when you look at their cooldowns, you look where Punk is at the EMP, this Nano Tito Watt, Nano Mirror, one of the two, try to force the Transcendence early, try to force these cooldowns out early. There's the Trance out. Now Punk, all he has to do is not die, and he's dead.
Yeah, as you're saying, not die, Punk was hitting the ground. Gator moving forward, uses the Shatter, knocks two to the ground, finishes it off, and Gator with three before it's all said and done. And that's problematic for Uprising. They kind of need the EMP there. Didn't happen because Punk was the first one to fall. And now Atlanta with really good options moving forward. And expect Astro to do something he doesn't do a lot of hiding.
For Atlanta Academy, they don't even have to necessarily commit full to the hide for right now because they have Grav. They have Grav early. They have Rally. If they set up this engage fast while put, because there is no D.Va to eat this, there is no Transcendence to Scalar's on the Ana, grabbing early, finishing the fight, building up their next trance.
Well, they're going to grab first as expected, forcing out the beat on the other side. Sugarfree moving in. Sugarfree immediately repelled. Sugarfree and Gator just bounced. It's Uprising. They invest quite a bit on the defensive ult side. And Atlanta, they don't have the personnel to defend this. This is going to be point A going for the Uprising.
I don't call it too early. There always is a chance they're going to recontest, but I think Atlanta are probably not going to do that.
They're nowhere near. They have all committed to point B.
I think they have fully committed to the point B push. They did get the EMP. They did get the Shatter, the beat for Uprising. So they don't have ults to snowball this effectively. Uprising does not have ults to snowball this effectively. Atlanta will have double support ult and the Shatter, the bomb. So a lot in their wheelhouse to work with. And when they're running Hawk on this D.Va, and Uprising is currently on the Sabra, just win the shield war. Win the shield war. Set up Gator.
We'll see if they're able to do just that as they move forward. Scalar going to use the Nano Boost early. Uprising going to try and use that to pierce on through, forcing out the Transcendence at Kodak for Atlanta. And the Transcendence more than enough to punish Tito Watt. you know what, well, of course, was a little bit deeper. And Punk able to get some progress on the point there. Uprising, they don't leave empty-handed.
Punk continuing to prioritize the point a lot of these fights rather than the poke damage, which I think, considering we know how Atlanta loves to play, they love to play so aggressively, and they like to abuse the fact that they have the D.Va and Uprising does not, and you see this against teams that play Sombra Gonce against them all the time. Your ideal scenario then is you want to play a little bit more passive and have Punk be the one that if they're engaging on you, then Punk is getting point cap, and I think that's fine.
So Uprising gonna be resetting here. They have both Grav and EMP up for the next fight. Astro has a beat, but beat not gonna be able to deal with both of those at the same time. So opportunity here for Uprising.
EMP Grav up. They could look for the EMP nade. I mean, there's no transcendence for Kodak, though there is a beat for Astro, so the EMP and the grab is very much zoning. That's a zoning grab.
That is not what you want. And even as that goes on, Swimmer has a great play, ends up taking down Sugarfree, the aid of Mirror, but that's just not the ideal Graviton for Uprising. Punk gonna drop the EMP here. Transcends out from Kodak to neutralize, and Atlanta not out of the woods here yet. I mean, they are quite a bit needed down two. You can see the self-destruct moving up and over here. Hawk gets Scalar, and Atlanta, they will be repelling Uprising. Not as clean as they'd like, but definitely worthwhile, and I gotta say, Grav from Mirror needed to be better.
Uprising almost still managing to salvage that because of Swimmer's pick onto Sugarfree earlier, and then the EMP from Punk while Kodak is trancing. I mean, Punk is able to get that EMP and catch Astro and delete the beat. But Atlanta recognizing that even though they were down those ults and Uprising had that point presence, all they had to do was grab and set up a bomb. If it's exactly what they did, they win the fight because they have those free grabs while Punk is on Sombra. And now Uprising, they didn't get any more point time. They didn't really get any more ult charge either. Punk is only not even quite 50% to the EMP. And for Atlanta, they're coming up on a double support very soon on the Shatter. They can look to win the Shield War, put Gator in a position where you can succeed.
Atlanta holding back, going to Uprising. It's fine. You guys can make the first move. We will wait here and drain the clock until you decide to do so. And Uprising taking quite a bit of time. I think they're just waiting for Mirror to get grab.
Mirror does have that grab up. They're looking for the engage right now. They're hoping they can burn some supports early and set up Punk for that EMP post fight.
Whoa, Shatter in from Gator, puts everyone on the ground. Immediate fall through there, and Atlanta just ruining Uprising's day off that Shatter in from Gator.
And Tidawatt just didn't have a shield where it needed to be. Gator just walks to the other side of the shield. Tidawatt was looking for a Shatter of his own. Puts himself in a spot where his cover, his big rectangle, is not covering his team. And Gator sees that, puts the Shatter on the ground, wins the fight. They traded beats. But if you're Atlanta, that's a fine situation to be in for trading beats, because now you have a grab and you can engage early. For Uprising, when you have about a minute 30 by the time they're back, they need to commit to a fight soon. If they can get grab out early, maybe trade grabs a Saucy, they're in a good spot, then Punk can then have a free EMP knowing that Astro is on a beat.
We'll see how Punk looks to set up the EMP here. Mirror holding onto the grab in reserve. They're gonna open up the EMP, they get three immediately. Kodak in danger. Kodak though still somehow alive. Finally finish off Swimmer, able to finish it on the same note, but it's 5-on-5, the EMP not the greatest. Gator again drops the Shatter, knocks down two, gets the pin on the other side, and Gator's Shatters have been game-changing for Atlanta.
Swimmer gets another frag, but that's it, the fight's over. Even with Swimmer managing to pick up Kodak there early, the grab from Saucy comes out, it's peel. Part of the reason why they couldn't get Kodak was because of that peel grab from Saucy, and then Gator just puts the Shatter again on the ground, everyone down. Uprising, they're at their final push. They have grabbed. They're coming up on Shatter, but they're going to have to deal with the transfer. Kodak, he didn't even use it in that fight.
Not only Transcendence, but also Hawk could just use a defensive bomb as well. The Graviton is not going to be enough. Uprising needs this to be a longer fight where they out-mechanically play Atlanta, but that has not been the name of the game here so far.
Well, if they can actually manage to get a nade. A nade is still possible. They can look for the grab, look for the nade. They need Hawk to use that Matrix, especially while he's bombing. There's no Matrix on the field to stop the nade.
Graviton is in. The nade only hits Gator. Atlanta able to get their way through it. The nade has faltered. Atlanta still in the fight. Rally in progress. Tidawatt holding onto the Shatter. Tidawatt gonna drop the Shatter. Doesn't get anything from it. I think he might get interrupted mid-Shatter as well. I'm not sure the hammer ever hit the ground. Hawk, though, gonna get demeched. Uprising still around. The nano boost invested. A little bit of room being made. Atlanta backing up. Still five up. Gator, though, another Shatter. We know this is gone. Drop the Shatter one more time. Knocks down one. Graviton invested at the same time. Onek able to get one from that, and Uprising now starting the falter. Too much damage in from Atlanta. The Bionade hits two, but the falter is not going to be there.
And even if Mirror gets grabbed, he's going to be focused down very early. That's that. Uprising, they're done. And they just couldn't find that value what they needed from the nade. Realistically, that was what it was. They had to win the fight off the nade, because the longer the fight ran, the better it is for Atlanta when you're playing against that Zen. Even if you get a nano, it doesn't matter, because Trance is just the better ult. Trance is just the far better ult. You have the Discord orb. So the longer the fight ran, eventually Atlanta was going to win it.
So Atlanta, their victory condition, very, very simple. Simply get point A and then get 50% of point B, and that will be enough to go into the half 2-0 and still well on the way to the Astro goal of 28-0.
Which he must meet. He must meet unless he wants to give me the Weetabix. Once again,
I can't believe that's a thing. I mean, I believe you that's a thing, but I still, I'm in awe. That I'm just calling it the UK Vegemite. It's the only thing I can do.
I mean, this sounds like a man that hasn't had his blocks of wheat for the day. A little grumpy. If you're not waking up every day with a nice block of wheat.
How old do you think I am?
Well, like, it's not about age here. You're misconstruing the situation. It's about culinary finesse. And that is what you have a block of wheat for. It's for that sole purpose.
All I know is that, I will be sad on some level when I get to the era where, you know, it's 5 a.m., just waking up, doing some stretches, get my block of wheat, go out, get my lawnmower, and mow the lawn. Let's avoid that era for now. As it said, we look to the Uprising defense, where they're going to be running the Sombra on the defense, and Atlanta, I have to say, with them running 3-3, they're just going to be running directly into him.
What is this? A Hammond? Surely it's just for scouting. I doubt that Atlanta commit to the Hammond play. It is possible. But no, Gator just rolls forward for a quick scout and rolls on back to the spawn. Not going to make the swap onto the Reinhardt. And with Atlanta on the standard 3-3 here, their goals are not to have long rotations. They don't want long rotations here versus Uprising Academy. The longer the rotations are, the more chance for Scaler to get a nade, the more time for Punk to build EMP. They just want to take the fight extremely quickly, extremely aggressively, move it towards the point.
That was also a very quick rotation. They weren't really dinged up at all as they went in. They're able to evict Uprising. They're more powerful in the early fight until Punk is able to get EMP or perhaps a really good hack, but you can't really rely on getting a good hack here. And they're just sending Uprising back. And Uprising, the running have space to back up, and it's all water behind the Kodak gets two.
And that's first. Gator does go down, but everyone else cleaned up. Atlanta Academy, look at their ults. Gator already with that shatter, so aggressive. He just did not stop walking forward. Because when there's no D.Va on the field, there's one less target, there's one less hero that's effectively very, very effective at burning main tanks. And it's a D.Va, and when that's gone, Gator can feel a lot less free, he has a lot less shield pressure. And Atlanta played that masterfully in terms of knowing all they had to do was just take a fight.
Gator, if he had a model right now, it's can't stop, won't stop. And Atlanta just gonna move in onto the point. Gator holding onto the shatter. Onek attacked early on, which means hack isn't on Gator as Gator drops a hammer once more. Putting both ults to the ground. Saucy there in the follow through. EMP comes out from Punk though, but the problem is it's already two members down by the time the EMP is there. The follow through, it's not there. They can't even stay on the point. Atlanta finishing off Paris. Now up 2-0 here in the series.
A very fast Paris. That was a very, very fast Paris as well. When you look at Atlanta, this is a team. There's a reason they're so strong. There's a reason they went to the Atlantic Showdown. There's a reason that they're still rated very highly. And that Uprising, they play a composition that it can find value, but Atlanta knows how to counter it. Just apply fight directly to forehead. Walk in. And that is exactly what they do.
Yeah, and that's why when we see other teams run 3-3 versus 3-2-1, we go, you got to get aggressive. You got to go into them. Stop wasting time. Stop doing long rotations. And Atlanta, they're good enough to know those basics about how you engage in these situations. And I mean, it's why we hype up Atlanta to the degree that we have. They're not just a team that got to the Atlantic Showdown. They are a dominant force in NA Contenders Overwatch, period.
And it looks like it's going to continue to be so. I mean, they don't show any signs of stopping so far. Uprising was going to be, it's not necessarily a shoe-in as of this point by any means. Uprising is not a shoe-in to be necessarily a top team this season, especially in their or in their bracket. But a stronger team, a team that performed well in trials, that have had success in the past, even if they did get relegated. So really running over an Uprising here, if this continues in this fashion, Atlanta are continuing to show that dominance moving forward.
Well, Uprising. They still have two more maps to go if they are going to reverse course here. Or is Atlanta just going to continue to cruise on to their 8-0 starting record here in Contender Season 2? We'll find out in just a few minutes.